property, that would make sense. That's the only way that would make sense.
Like, that's literally the point.
I'm not saying you're wrong, I'm trying to make a point. Just have to.
That's what I was doing, I just didn't have physical control of it.
Yeah.
We debated whether or not there was a moment there.
You're saying there's a reaction force here.
I got stuck.
The force is here. So it is on like on that top point.
No, that's how I was doing it, but.
And that makes sense, but at the same time, you're pushing against, like you're pushing against the wall.
Yes.
Right?
Twice.
Because that reaction force, because that reaction.
It was in
I think after deleting number one.
Yeah, I realized like when I was in case
you know,
I felt a lot of confidence in myself.
And I won't.
So like instance.
Right, what's that much of our goal itself? She had just right here.
Yeah, that's great.
How could you like, oh, I don't have solved any goals.
Oh, shit.
No. So I went back to the point, and I was like, that's not my goal.
Alright guys, last lecture. So we're going to spend today talking about the types of forces that occur on immersed bodies, namely lift and drag. These things that as engineers we're usually most interested in. How can we use these fluid forces to help keep something afloat, generate a steering thrust or a steering moment, thrust the propeller, etc., etc., and how much are we going to have to pay to do it, which comes from the drag. So I've showed this slide a couple of times, but recall that the idea is that flow over a body induces two kinds of stresses on each little element of the surface. Stresses that are normal to the surface, generally come from pressure, and those that occur tangentially to the surface we call shear stresses, namely stresses at the wall. So if I draw this little elemental area here, let's go ahead and say that this is at some angle theta, measured from the horizontal plane here, and draw normal and a tangential unit vector on that. Then if I go ahead and propose that over this area there's some force incident on it, let's say dF, we can decompose this force into a component that is normal to the surface here. So we would say this is the pressure times dA times normal, and a component that occurs along the surface here, which would be tau wall dA t hat. Alright, now the other thing that we can do with this, if I establish my coordinate direction such that x, y, where x is, we'll go ahead and say this is the direction that some inflow is occurring. Velocity u. Then I can go ahead and write that my normal vector is equal to, in this case it's going to be negative cosine theta I plus sine theta j, and the tangential vector is equal to sine theta I plus cosine theta j. Right? These are these two vectors written in this coordinate frame. So if I go ahead and write out the force, the force here on the body, I could write that df is equal to p times dA times n plus tau w times dA times the tangential vector, which is, if I apply these expression or these definitions of the normal tangential vector, would be equal to dA. Negative p. This term. I need to have a negative here. Negative p dA times negative cosine theta I plus sine theta j plus tau wall dA sine theta I plus cosine theta j. And if I do some reorganization in here, I can get a component that says dFx here, which we call the differential element of the drag, is equal to negative, is equal to p dA cosine theta, the I component here, plus tau wall dA sine theta. And I would say that dFy, or the component that's in the y direction, is equal to some component, some part, little piece of the lift, negative p dA sine theta plus tau wall dA cosine theta. All right, so what does this actually mean? You know, what's the real, why go through this process just to write out the components of this little force that are in the x and y direction? Well, because if we integrate over the entire body of the the entire surface of whatever body we have here, in this case it's an airfoil, but it could be arbitrary, it's, you know, any blob of space, then we're going to end up with, these are what I just derived, then we're going to end up with expressions that look like this, right? If we integrate all the little differential elements of drag and lift, or fx and fy, then we're gonna get these expressions here for the total lift and drag. And the thing I wanted to point out here is that this is really just a transformation of coordinates, right? We have lift due to shear stress on the wall, which occurs tangentially, forces due to shear stress on the wall, which occurs tangentially to the surface everywhere, and due to pressure on the wall, which occurs normal to the surface everywhere. And those components, the pressure and the shear stress, show up in both the lift and the drag. So we have shear stress here, and we have the pressure there and there. So we have kind of multiple ways that we can write total force on the body. The way that we just derived was, you know, the total force on a body is equal to lift I plus, drag I plus lift j. The other way we could write it is F is equal to F shear plus pressure, where each of these components is going to have an x and a y component. It's on the orientation of the body. Right. So these are equivalent expressions. So we have shear and pressure components of both lift and drag. So from this process, we can see that we're gonna take a moment here. Like, we talked about lift and drag, but we're gonna focus on drag first. First half of this talk. And so what this process here and that expression for forces demonstrates is that we can decompose the components of each force, that is, the drag up there, the big D. We can decompose the drag into a component due to friction and due to what we call form drag. Friction results from shear stress along the wall, right? This is a fairly intuitive connection. And then form drag is what is the component that we attribute to the X component of this pressure force, right? The drag component of that. So the balance of these two, or sort of the relative importance of form drag versus friction drag, depends on a couple of things. We've already talked about most of them. Reynolds number being one, right? Because Reynolds number dictates how important viscous stresses are, viscous forces are relative to inertial forces. But also, it depends highly upon the shape. For example, I mentioned in an earlier lecture that the idea of bluff bodies versus streamlined bodies, right? Bluff bodies, which have high degree of curvature and which tend to experience flow separation. We'll talk a little bit more about that in the next few slides. But the idea is that Reynolds number tends to feed into friction drag and to a lesser degree also into form drag, while the shape of the body feeds largely into the form drag, because the shape of the body and how streamlined it is dictates how much flow separation occurs. And flow separation is the major contributor to form drag. So if we have a bluff body, something like a cylinder that has flow separation over the entire after body of it, and we compare it to something that's quite streamlined, like a NACA foil section here, the idea is that these two bodies, drawn to scale, will have the same amount of pressure drag. If we were to integrate the forces around them, then the amount of the X component of the force due to pressure is going to be equivalent between the two. This, of course, has a larger surface area, so the friction drag will be larger, but again, you kind of have to consider each of these things in turn. So one of the takeaways from this, and one of the things I want to kind of finish with, is the idea that if there's no viscosity, okay, we talked about this before, something we call the D'Alembert's paradox. If there's no viscosity in a fluid, then we don't get any drag or lift. And this has a lot to do with, well, if there's no viscosity, of course there won't be no friction drag, no shear stresses on the wall. What's interesting, though, is to look at why we end up with zero form drag when we look at a fluid with zero viscosity. So, again, this will be in a couple slides. All right, perfect. So, let's consider first a quick example. Okay, yeah, we're gonna start off with a quick example. Say we have a flat plate, okay, which is aligned with a uniform incoming flow. The question is, what is going to be the drag coefficient on this plate? Okay, so that's all the information we get, and that's actually all the information we need for this problem. So how should we proceed? Well, in order to get the drag coefficient, we first need the drag, right? The drag coefficient we defined as drag, previously we defined this as one half rho u squared times a. Let's go ahead and say that this plate has dimensions of L long, and we'll go ahead and say that it has it's B wide, right? So that the area is equal to LB. Drag over 1/2 rho u squared LB. So what we need to know is we need to figure out what the drag is. So if we come over here, we look at this expression right here, right? The component of drag, we go ahead and integrate this. We can write drag is equal to the integral of P cosine theta plus the expression for the drag force in the x direction. If we look at this, if theta is defined as the angle of the normal vector, right, measured from the horizontal plane, then for a horizontal plate, something that's aligned with the flow, theta is going to be pi over 2, which means that this component is always going to be equal to 0, and this component is always going to be equal to 1, right? So in other words, our drag turns into a much simpler integral of integral over the surface of tau wall dA, where if this is a rectangular plate, like we said before, we could say the drag is equal to B integral from 0 to L tau wall dx. All right, next question. How do we get tau wall? This is the shear stress due to fluid viscosity developed in the boundary layer, right? There's going to be a boundary layer that develops on this plate. It's what causes all things shear stressy. And we spent the last week talking about different boundary layer theories. If we go ahead and assume for this case that let's say that the let's make the assumption that the flow is laminar. So what we have is laminar flow over a flat plate such that there is no pressure gradient in the x direction. Anyone remember what theory uses these two assumptions exactly? This is the canonical boundary layer flow. Remember what the exact solution for laminar boundary layers is called? These are the two assumptions that fed directly into the Blasius solution for boundary layer flow, right? So in the Blasius solution, remember it involved, we started with Navier-Stokes, we knocked a bunch of terms out of Navier-Stokes, and then we transformed the remaining equations into ones that were, instead of being partial differential equations, were a single higher order ordinary differential equation, which are solved using the computer. And so the transformation variable for the velocity solution looked like we had this eta variable, which is to the square root of u over nu x. And we had the identity that we had this function f. We said that df d eta is equal to little u over bit u. Don't worry if you don't remember these definitions. These were sort of obscure definitions of the transformation that Blasius came up with in order to get to a solution. But these are sort of built into the Blasius solution procedure. So this means if we're looking for tau at the wall, we know that tau at the wall is defined as du dy at y equals 0, which we can write as du d eta at, let's see, well, let's say du d eta times d eta dy, all of this at it'll be y equals eta equals 0. So if we go ahead and use the chain rule, we move this u over here, so we say that little u is equal to big U times f prime eta. We take the derivative of u with respect to eta, we end up with this term being big U f double prime eta, and then d eta dy, oops, there's supposed to be a y out here, it's just going to be big U over nu x, root nu x, so anyway, so plugging this all in, what we end up with is u squared rho x, which is equal to u squared rho 1 over the root of the Reynolds number times d squared f d eta squared d squared f d eta squared. All right. So I know I'm kind of jumping around back and forth here. So to kind of recap what we've done so far with this, we've said we have a flat plate. This is amenable to the Blasius solution. It satisfies all the assumptions. Laminar flow. Flat aligned with the flow. So the Blasius solution was built using these transformation variables. And I know that what I'm looking for is the shear stress at the wall. So using the expression for shear stress at the wall for a Newtonian fluid, right? Velocity gradient at the wall times the viscosity. Then I can go ahead. I have u and I have y, which are involved in those transformation variables for Blasius over there. So I can go ahead and use the chain rule to write tau at the wall in terms of these transformation variables. And so just plugging these in with the chain rule, I end up with this expression right here. Let me go ahead and write this a little bigger so I see some people at the back of the room kind of straining to see it. Tau wall is equal to rho big U squared and just going through the process, straight up calc 1, chain rule, differentiation, then I end up with this expression here. So, great, U, easy, Reynolds number, easy. The question is where we get this quantity here, and also we need to make sure that this is evaluated at the wall, which is where eta is equal to 0. So in order to get that quantity, we turn to these pre-computed tables, right? This is a numerically integrated equation, the velocity solution. We don't actually solve the differential equation ourselves. We let some algorithm do it for us. And so we end up with these lists of f, f prime, and f double prime. Right? This is exactly what we want right there. So we want f double prime at eta equals 0. 0.3321. So we just plug that value in here. 0.332. We end up with 0.332. Okay, so now if we wanted to integrate this over the surface of the plate, right, in order to get the result from drag, so drag would be the integral from B times the integral from 0 to L of rho u squared 0.332 over the square root of Reynolds number with respect to x dx. Alright, there's only one thing in here that depends on x, and that's the Reynolds number, so we can move everything else. These terms we can move outside of the integral, leaving us with rho u squared b times 0.332 times integral from 0 to L root nu over u x. These components also are constant on x, so we can move those outside as well, giving us an even simpler integral, rho u squared b 0.332 root nu over u 0 to L integral 1 over x dx. Okay, so if we go ahead and crunch through this integral, what we end up with is, since this is x negative 1/2, we know that its integral is just going to be 2 times x to the 1/2, right? So we end up with 2x 1/2, 0 to L, which gives us 2 root L. Plug that in over here, and what we end up with is rho u squared b L 0.3321 over Reynolds number spent with respect to L. And last thing is getting the drag coefficient out of this, where the drag coefficient just means we divide out 1/2 rho u squared a, where a is equal to L times b, which leaves us with the final solution here of, we put this whole thing over 1/2 rho u squared L b, we get rho canceling, u squared canceling, L b canceling. Oh, this is supposed to be times 2, isn't it? So this actually is 0.664. And so we end up with the C drag coefficient is equal to, finally, 1.33 over the square root of the Reynolds number defined with respect to length of the plate. All right, show of hands if you understand the process to get to this point, at least. Or is there anyone that's like, what the hell did he just do? Who's Blasius? All right. So this case, right, where if we have a flat plate aligned with flow, this can be thought of sort of the ultimate streamlined body, right? If it has zero thickness, then it just, you can sort of figure it, it kind of slots into the flow and doesn't cause any deflection of streamlines around it, right? And if the streamlines don't have to deflect around it, that means there's no pressure gradient around it because the pressure along the streamlines remains constant. And as a result, there's no pressure drag. That's sort of what we see here too, right? The fact that it's completely aligned with the flow means there's no surface for pressure to act on in the direction of drag. So this is a case that can be thought of as having purely a frictional drag component. Okay, so we'd have dP plus dF, where this would feed in the drag term, this would feed in the friction term. And so as a result, we saw that this went away, leaving us with only a frictional drag body. Which tells us that frictional drag occurs on surfaces that are aligned with the flow. Now, a little thought experiment here. What happens if we turned this plate at 90 degrees so that it was completely perpendicular to the flow? In this case, right, the normal defined with respect to the horizontal plane is zero, right? The angle of the normal, meaning these guys switch, pressure goes to one, the component of drag goes to zero, and we end up with something that is and we end up with a drag composed completely of pressure drag, right? So the idea here is that, again, if you have some surface that, some component or element of a surface of a body, right? This could be thought of as sort of a one little tiny infinitesimally small piece of a larger body. But if you have a body that is oriented with the flow, it's streamlined, then you're going to have a dominant frictional component. And if it's totally normal, such that it causes the flow to stagnate against it, you're going to have a large buildup of pressure with very little friction, frictional resistance. However, most real bodies aren't, you know, made up of flat plates, and so they kind of fall between these two extremes. You're not going to have something that's perfectly streamlined with zero thickness, and you're not going to have something that's or completely normal to the flow that also has zero thickness. And as a result, the fact that most bodies kind of fall in the spectrum of completely pressure drag and completely friction drag based, as a result of this, the component, or the drag on a body is highly dependent upon the shape of the body itself. For example, this is what the flow around this plate normal to alright, so if there's flow coming in from where I'm standing, carrying the plate, then what you end up with is this flow separation. So you end up with this large buildup of pressure on this side and this region of low pressure on this side, which causes a large drag component. No friction responsible for, or no direct frictional shear stress on the plate. something like a, something like an ellipse here will have some friction, frictional resistance on the components of the surface that are aligned with the flow, and also a pressure component developing from stagnation pressure here, and a low pressure in the separated region here. And then probably the most fun is if you've seen these sort of indoor skydiving things, right? There's the idea that the user, by streamlining themselves, can reduce their drag, which is ultimately what's keeping them aloft, right? It's drag, it's aligned with the flow. Can reduce their drag, and by expanding their component and behaving more like a flat plate, can increase their drag and reach higher heights. So because we don't have the theory to account for all of these, you know, infinite variations in the shape of a body, we've used things like dimensional analysis, reduction of governing equations, and model testing, stuff we talked about 2 weeks ago, to come up with big tables of drag coefficients for common shapes. So for two-dimensional bodies, things like squared rods, triangles, semicircular shells, rectangles, lots of canonical different canonical shapes, you can look up what the reference area used in computing the drag coefficient is to find S for those shapes. And then you can look at the drag coefficient itself, sometimes as a function of things like the how rounded these corners are relative to the length of one side. Or for others, or the aspect ratio of a rectangle. For three-dimensional shapes, same thing. You can look up what the reference area to be used is and look up the drag coefficient. Remember that, so usually in cases like this, tests are conducted at large enough Reynolds numbers that people are comfortable saying that the effective Reynolds number has disappeared. Remember, Reynolds number becomes decreasingly important as it gets higher. And so if you take a large enough Reynolds number, at some point you can say it's only a function of the body shape. Viscous effects themselves have been minimized about as small of a component as we were going to get them. So these, the Reynolds numbers for which each of these tests is valid, for each of these modeling results is valid, is given in the rightmost column. And this kind of speaks to, if you remember, previously with the dimensional analysis, you might say that drag is some function of, maybe length, width, viscosity, rho. And what we got was that you could essentially say that the drag coefficient here is equal to some unknown function of maybe width and Reynolds number, where this essentially describes the shape of the body, right? You're going to have some number of variables that describe the shape of the body. But if you do a geometrically similar model as a geosim, then you can be sure that this is always going to be equal to y, or that this is always going to be similar. And so you could say, for example, if you're taking a sphere or a rectangle, you know that at any scale, when you scale that model down, the shape of it's going to remain similar. So you end up with perhaps CD rectangle is just now a function of Reynolds number. And so in our discussion of correlating modeling tests, this basically means that you can represent the results as a single plot in two dimensions, right? Where CD is a function of Reynolds number, and you might have something that looks like this, right? And the big word of caution when we talked about model testing was if you have a relationship that you can describe as two pi groups or two dimensionless variables, and you write and you do model tests and come up with a representation of this behavior in a graph, the important thing was to not extrapolate beyond the range in which you tested. For example, if you obtained results here, 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 then you may be inclined to say, oh, well, these results are just constant, right? You end up with a constant drag coefficient, which might miss some of the actual behavior that you didn't test over here as small Reynolds numbers. So whoever did these experiments that led to these big tables of results basically said either that the data collapsed much better and was more easily scaled for large Reynolds numbers greater than, in usually in most of these cases, Reynolds number times 10 to the fourth. The other reason for this might be as you change, even though the shape may stay similar, as you increase or decrease the size of the model, you may have different behaviors that kind of look like this, right? You could have all your data kind of wandering all over the place with different model scales at small Reynolds numbers and collapsing to a common curve at large Reynolds numbers, at which point you can say that it's no longer dependent on the Reynolds number. So, anyway, this is not a very scientific drawing, by the way. I wouldn't recommend using that for anything. So, alright, so the drag is highly dependent upon the shape. And let's talk a little bit more about why this happens. Like, what are the physics that drive this this development of pressure drag in particular? We understand viscous drag, more or less, the frictional drag component, because it comes from boundary layers, right? Whenever there's viscosity, there will be a boundary layer, there will be a velocity gradient, and then by Newton's relationship for viscosity and wall shear stress, there will be a shear stress which integrates to give us a frictional force. But it makes, the idea of why you get a pressure drag on a body that is smooth, something like a cylinder, is a little bit more nuanced. So we're going to take a couple minutes to look at this. I mentioned it before. This all boils down to, once again, thing that we call D'Alembert's paradox. So if we are starting out with an inviscid flow, something like a potential flow, using stream functions, the Euler equations, etc., we plop a cylinder into the middle of this. You guys remember what velocity potentials you have to combine to get a cylinder sitting in a flow? One would be a uniform flow, right? If you were to say, I want the velocity potential a cylinder in flow, you'd end up with a doublet plus a uniform flow potential, right? The velocity potential and the Laplace equation are linear. You can combine the different types of flows. So the uniform flow would describe everything that's going on here, and then the doublet would provide this set of streamlines that look like a cylinder plopped in the middle of it. So the way that we did this before, right? When we were trying to figure out what the forces on the cylinder were. So we used potential flow, right? Potential flow. We used this to get the velocities of the flow, which we fed into the Bernoulli equation to get the pressures on the surface, which we then integrated to get the total force on the body, right? So by plugging in the velocities, which remember V is equal to grad phi for potential flow, by using this to get the velocities and then the pressures on the body, we're able to plot out the pressure. We got the velocity, the total magnitude of the flow speed on the cylinder surface as a function of the angular distance measured from the upstream direction. So we saw that we had zero speed at the stagnation points at A and F, and speed reached a maximum at C, right? And so plugging those into the Bernoulli equation, we ended up with stagnation pressure at A minimum pressure at C, and stagnation pressure again at F. All right, so to kind of run through what this means is the Bernoulli equation is really an energy balance, right? It's representing the trade-off between kinetic energy that say Bernoulli, we end up saying that V plus 1/2 rho mu squared plus rho g z is equal to constant, right? Which really tells us that pressure and gravitational energy can be thought of as potential energy sources. And this can be thought of as kinetic energy, right? So how much energy is available, how much is going into moving the fluid around, and it remains constant. This tells us that this is essentially, it describes a reversible or completely perfect system where any energy that gets dumped into velocity from this potential sources can be recovered back to potential energy. In other words, flow upstream here is going to have some potential, some kinetic energy. Comes up here, it hits A, right? It stagnates. U goes to zero, all the kinetic energy gets lost, and instead it builds up into this high pressure here, so you have high potential energy. Then over the front end of this cylinder, you have what is called a favorable pressure gradient. In other words, this tells you that the pressure is decreasing in the direction of travel. What this means is that low pressure in front, high pressure behind, means the fluid element tends to get accelerated. In other words, we end up with this transfer of potential towards... So here we have large potential energy. On this part, we have... On this region here where we have a favorable pressure gradient, we have potential energy feeding into kinetic energy until it reaches a maximum speed here with a minimum pressure. That is, here we have large kinetic energy, and then on the afterbody we have what is called an adverse pressure gradient, which basically says fluid element moving along sees higher pressure in front, lower pressure behind, which means it starts to decelerate, or the kinetic energy starts reducing and it starts feeding back into potential energy. It's the same sort of idea as, you know, a ball rolling down a hill, losing potential energy, picking up maximum kinetic energy at the bottom, and rolling up to the same distance on the other side of the hill. The problem is that just as balls rolling down hills don't behave the way we want them to, right? The idea of a ball and a ramp, it's if you roll it from a certain height in a circular ramp, right? If you have a ball and a ramp like this, and you roll it down, it's never actually going to make it up to this side, right? In real life. And the reason for that is You have these nasty things that Bernoulli and potential energy ignore called losses. Recall it may be wind resistance, it may be rolling friction, maybe a rock in the middle of the this ramp. But the gist of it is that is that this idea of, or the idea that this is constant, we can't really believe that. That's not necessarily true in a real fluid. In fact, in a real fluid, what happens, so if we were to integrate for this inviscid case, right, where this is constant, when we integrated the forces around this, we saw that there was no drag and no pressure, because the pressure distribution was symmetric, right? However, in a real fluid, one where there is viscosity, we have the same sort of, you know, thing going on at the front, right? Flow upstream, encounters the body, it stagnates, large potential energy, small kinetic energy, and it starts moving around the flow, it speeds up, loses potential energy to kinetic energy, then hits this adverse pressure gradient on the afterbody, right? This is the inviscid solution. Hits the adverse pressure gradient on the afterbody, and all of a sudden, it starts slowing down, and at some point, it reaches a velocity of zero. Reason is that a lot of your kinetic energy in this transfer of energy throughout the different terms of the Bernoulli equation, a bunch has gone missing in this heat-generating nuisance we call a boundary layer. Okay, so there's all this friction, all this eddying energy going on here, just getting dissipated in the form of thermal energy. I mentioned before that, you know, friction, as with any system, friction in a fluid tends to generate heat, just dissipated away as unrecoverable thermal losses. Thermal losses generally are a real pain, but because they ruin our ability to use things like these recoverable or reversible system analogies. Anyway, so if there are these losses going on everywhere inside the boundary layer, then the idea is at some point, at this point D here, there is no longer enough kinetic energy to feed back into the potential energy. So when you hit this adverse pressure gradient, at some point the fluid's gonna slow down, stop, and there's still going to be a higher pressure in front of it than behind it. And so what happens then is that the fluid starts heading back in the other direction. It has to go back upstream, which is what we call flow reversal and flow separation. So when that flow starts heading back upstream, you end up with this pocket of recirculating flow that you see here, which forces the streamlines to detach, leaving you with this big, swirling, eddying, separated mess of flow behind the body. Okay. So there are a number of a couple of theories. A lot of them based on, you know, similar in their approach to things like the Blasius solution. You'll have time to hit those later on in your scholastic careers. But the idea is that the velocity profiles that you might see in the boundary layer may look something like this. You know, at A, A doesn't really make much sense, at B here, where the flow is still attached, you're going to have this this very Blasius-like nice boundary layer flow. At C, where the pressure is minimum and the kinetic energy is maximum. And then as the pressure, you know, at this point, then as the pressure starts to recover on the afterbody, as the pressure starts to increase and the flow is decelerating, you start to see that you have the flow at the wall is starting to get pushed back. In other words, the velocity profile is starting to go towards zero at points other than at the wall exactly. So when separation occurs, or this point D here is what we would call the separation point. And there are two requirements to define a separation point. One is that partial U, partial Y must be equal to zero. In other words, this tells us that, you know, the flow at the wall is always zero. But if the slope of the flow at the wall is also zero, that means that there has to be zero velocity some distance away from the wall as well, right? That you can go out here and see that the flow, some infinitesimally small distance where you'd ordinarily have a forward flow, that instead the flow there is stagnated. And at the same time, we have to have an adverse pressure gradient, that is dp dx is greater than zero. So this tells us the flow has stopped, and this tells us that there's still a higher pressure upstream than downstream, which is, means the flow cannot start going again. So these are the two criterion classically used to define flow separation. And by the way, you'll notice that du dy here is exactly what shows up in our shear stress at the wall. So we could say here that equals zero. So we could also define this as shear stress at the wall equal to zero. This is the point where flow separates, describes the conditions at D. So flow separation clearly, because it depends upon the distribution of terms in the Bernoulli equation, as well as how quickly energy is dissipated from kinetic and potential energy sources into the boundary layer, it depends on the shape and on the Reynolds number, right? We can't get away from that. However, there are a few shapes that are kind of the common canonical shapes. One is a circular cylinder, like this example here, where it's a two-dimensional shape. And another is the sphere, right? The classical ball moving through a fluid. So for flow over a sphere, there are generally two types of separation that occur, and those depend on the behavior of the boundary layer. So if you have a laminar boundary layer, there's theory that tells us that separation occurs at there's a more advanced theory, something we haven't gotten into, that tells us that separation occurs at an angle measured from the upstream of 82.5 degrees. And if the flow is turbulent, I gotta remember the, I think that for turbulent flow, it occurs at 105 degrees, but I'm not 100% sure. It is written in the book somewhere. But the idea is that laminar flow separates further upstream than turbulent flow. This can occur at different, laminar turbulence, the difference here between the two boundary layer regimes can occur in one case because perhaps the Reynolds number is much higher. But remember, we also have this trick I mentioned we call tripping, where you can put something like, you can put like a bunch of sand dots or, you know, glue some sandpaper to the upstream flow here, which causes the flow to become messy upstream and sort of creates this turbulence artificially. So this is, I should mention, if I go back to this slide, the difference between laminar and turbulent flow can be seen in the pressure distributions here. So laminar flow, we see that the separation occurs just before 90 degrees. For turbulent flow, it looks like it's closer to 110, 115. Turbulent flow, because it occurs further downstream, we have less of a, we have a smaller region of separated flow, right? Our wake region is much smaller for turbulent flow. So for laminar flow, we'd have separation, something that looks like this, where we would have low pressures over the front here, and a much larger, we'd have high pressures over the front here, and a lower mean pressure over the whole of the back here. So, laminar, and if it's turbulent, we have a smaller wake region, which means that there's a smaller portion of the body that's subjected to this reduced average pressure in the wake. Meaning that the CD in laminar flow is greater than the drag coefficient in turbulent flow. Because the fact that the flow remains attached to longer in turbulent flow means that we're able to get more of this pressure recovered. We're able to get more of this pressure recovered over the afterbody of whatever's moving through the fluid. It's another example. It's another set of photos taken from the, I think it's the MIT Fluids Motion Gallery online, showing the flow over a laminar, or a sphere. This is actually a bowling ball in laminar and turbulent flow. We can see obviously the difference in how much of this body the flow is attached over, right? The turbulent case stays attached much longer, and so we're able to get this high pressure, this pressure recovery, sort of pushing the ball forward over some of the afterbody, whereas here the entire thing is in the wake. And so for this case, the drag coefficient is actually only about half of what it is in laminar flow. So I mentioned this once before, but this is exactly why things like golf balls, right, have those dimples on them. Because those dimples promote turbulence, which means that the air, the separation of the golf ball, instead of looking like this, will look more like this. Lower drag coefficient, which means your golf ball goes further, right? Okay, so we got a couple minutes oops. There we go. Go ahead and pull this. There we go. So if we leave out that idea of tripping, if we forget the dimples on the golf ball, and we say, all right, we're interested just the smooth sphere or smooth cylinder, then there have been probably cumulatively tens of thousands of experiments to look at the drag coefficient of spheres and cylinders as a function of Reynolds number. And sort of all of those data collapse onto something that looks like this, where the Reynolds number is in at low Reynolds numbers we have this we have very laminar flow, right? And the drag coefficient is actually a fairly strong function of the Reynolds number. At some point, we're usually around 10 to the third. So a Reynolds number of around 1,000. This is when we start getting into bodies that are large enough that we're actually interested in them as engineers. Okay, your golf ball, your baseball, your model moving through the water. And so we kind of lose that Reynolds number dependence, but we still have a fairly large drag coefficient. Then at some point, at a large enough Reynolds number, the flow transitions to turbulence and you have what's called the drag crisis, where it decreases suddenly, and this is due to that closing up of the separated wake, which means that you get some of that pressure back over the afterbody of the flow, and the drag coefficient drops precipitously. So this is stuff that you're going to probably spend a lot of time in 23:21. I think it's your next hydro-related course. Especially if Professor Bernices is teaching it, because he has based his entire research record on the behavior of cylinders and flows, right? Vortex-induced vibration, other cool stuff like that. So I'll leave that to him to go into more detail on. Let's do an example here. Let's imagine we have a float, right? Some spherical float with a specific gravity of 0.21. And a diameter of 30 centimeters, or a radius of 15 centimeters, and let's tie it to a river bottom. And if we come back and we observe that this float, it is an angle of 30 degrees relative to the horizontal, then using this information, we should be able to estimate what the current velocity in the river is. All right, so step one here. If I were to throw this onto a test, what would be your first move? Anyone? I hear some whispers. I don't want to say. I heard the correct whisper. I don't want to speak up. Thank you, Joey. Yes, free body diagram. So, we have our sphere. I'm going to go ahead and do the easy one here and say that force downward is going to be mg, right? What are the forces that are going to be present?
Buoyancy.
Drag, and then tension in the line, right? Tension, where this is at a 30 degree angle relative to the horizontal. So, the idea here is that this is staying put, it's steady, it's moving, so we can start solving for equilibrium. So sum of the forces in Y is equal to zero, which means that FB minus MG minus tension sine 30 degrees is equal to zero. So force of buoyancy and the weight of the body can be obtained from the fact that we have the specific gravity here, right? So in other words, we have rho of the body times g times volume. Rho of the water minus rho of the body times g times volume minus t, and sine of 30 degrees is equal to 1/2 equal to zero. We know the rho of body is equal to 0.21 times rho of water, so what we get is rho water g volume 1 minus 0.21 minus t over 2 is equal to 0. Or solving for t, yet t is equal to rho water g. Volume of a sphere is 4/3 pi r cubed, right? Times 0.79, which is the 1 minus 0.21. All times 2. So, writing that out. And does anybody, let's see, did I ever actually, I never got a number, but if anyone wants to, let's see. So this turns into 8/3 times 999 kilograms per meter cubed times 9.81 meters per second squared times pi 0.15 meters cubed times 0.79. Have a number.
Yeah, 218.9.
218.9. That sounds about right. 218.9 newtons. Okay. So that's some of the forces in Y. Some of the forces in X. Also equal to zero, which tells us that drag minus T cosine theta is equal to zero. Which tells us that D drag is equal to T cosine theta, which, and this one I do have written down, is going to be equal to 189 newtons. All right, so we know the drag. The question now is, how do we turn the drag into a prediction of what U is? So there are two things we got to do here. One is we have to, for a sphere, right, there's a very canonical shape. We know that generally, as I will in the last few slides, we know that we like to characterize the drag on a sphere based on the Reynolds number, right? Using some relationship between drag coefficient and Reynolds number. So if we go ahead and write the drag coefficient, which is equal to drag minus 1/2 rho u squared, projected area, which in this case is going to be equal to pi r squared. What we are going to end up with is, I think it is 5.35 over u squared. We know drag, we know rho, we know pi r squared, we just don't know u yet. At the same time, u we can then solve for as 5.35 over, which means that the Reynolds number based on diameter would be equal to, would be equal to UD over new should be equal to root 5.35 over CD times D over new. Anyway, so we have these we have these two equations here describing Reynolds number and drag coefficient, and we have all of these experimental results which have been collected over the years by intrepid experimentalists. So for the idea here is now we just have to use a kind of a trial and error approach. So for example, and I have a few of these already computed, if we were to pick a drag coefficient of 0.5 first, we would come along here, we would say, oh, smooth sphere. If we were to pick a drag coefficient of 0.5 first, we would get a, pick CD, U, Reynolds number, CD. Okay, if we were to pick a drag coefficient of 0.5 first, our resulting U, if we were to plug that into the first, or to the middle equation over there, our resulting U would be, forget this line here, plugging that in here, our U would be 3.27 meters per second, which gives us a Reynolds number of 8.76 times 10 to the fifth. So that'd be right up here somewhere, boom, which then spits out a drag coefficient of about 8.7 or 8.8 times 10^5, which spits out a drag coefficient of about 0.15. All right, so this and this do not match, so this does not work. So let's take another guess. Let's start out with a drag coefficient of 0.15. That's our input. 0.15. If we plug that in here, solve for u, we get 5.97 meters per second. 0.97 meters per second, which gives us a Reynolds number of 1.6 times 10 to the 6th, which gives us, spits us out here, which gives us a drag coefficient of about 0.2. So 1.6, e to the 6, 0.2. 0.15, 0.2, once again, they don't match. So let's pick something kind of between the two, right? We can see that here it appears we way overshot it, here we undershot it, but not by as much. So let's pick a value of 0.19. Well, gee, I wonder how he knew to pick that value. Plugging that in, we get velocity. Plugging that in here, we have a velocity of 5.3 meters per second, which gives us a Reynolds number of 1.42 times 10 to the 6th. So 10 to the 6th. So 1.42, that would be right around here. Is that right? 1.4. Sorry, my bad. Yeah, that's, so 1.1 times 10 to the 6th, 0.42 would be right around here. So it would be just below this line and coming just below 0.2. So we'll say this is about 0.19. It's a little hard to read off a graph this large, but the idea is now our input, our drag coefficient that we guess, and the one that the process spits out match, which means that we have made a consistent estimate of the drag coefficient. All right, so we've got about 5 minutes left. We have been concentrating on drag, because let's spend just the last couple of minutes talking about lift, right? So we've spent this entire time on drag. Lift, if you remember, there was a component. It's due to both pressure and viscous forces. However, in almost all cases, lift, which is, remember, lift is defined as the component of the force orthogonal to the inflow. That is if you have a flow velocity, which looks like this, then your lift is going to be, lift is equal to the force, which is perpendicular to the flow. Most lifting bodies, you know, the classic types of lifting bodies are those we call foils, which are the foundation of all modern weights, right? So foils are designed to be very streamlined. That is, they minimize the amount of flow separation by allowing an easy sort of curvature for the streamlines to stay attached. So they encourage attached flow to minimize the amount of pressure drag. Friction drag, you can't really do much about because it's really dependent on the Reynolds number. And then they generate lift through, through deflecting with respect to the inflow. So if we take a foil defined with some angle relative to the foil's kind of line of action, so at some angle relative to the inflow, we define that as our angle of attack. So we can rotate the whole system over so that the foil looks like it's flat, and we just approximate the inflow as occurring at some angle. So the lift and drag coefficients of wings in particular are generally dependent upon the angle of attack as well. And these have been characterized over the years through model tests, like this one from a huge, big reference book called Abbott and von Dunhoff, Theory of Wing Sections, where the angle of attack is on the x-axis here, and on the y-axis you'll have the lift coefficient. And what you generally get is something that looks quite linear. In fact, for two-dimensional foils, you generally find that the lift coefficient is approximately equal to 2 pi times the angle of attack measured in radians. Okay. So this is a classic linear result where the lift will increase with increasing angle of attack until you reach some large angle of attack, which we call stall. Right? And just as with the bluff body, right, it is as this angle of attack increases, eventually it will look to the incoming flow to be a bluff body. As it becomes less and less streamlined, you're forcing the streamlines to deflect further and further to conform to the surface of the foil. And so at some angle of attack, you're going to get flow separation, which is what we call stall. And when flow separation and stall occurs, you get this sudden drop in your angle of attack, or in your developed lift. Okay. So, and then this is all, we talked about the Kuda-Joukowsky theorem and how to get lift out of circulation. And I'll leave the rest of this, I guess, to what you see in later classes. So, in the last 100 or 90 seconds here, I want to do a quick little one-page recap of what we've covered. So, kind of our syllabus in review. So, in this course, you know, we came in not knowing anything about fluids, right? Started out defining fluids, the descriptions of a fluid, Eulerian, Lagrangian frames of reference, covering fluid properties, viscosity, density, and the constitutive laws, that is how we relate things like viscosity to shear stress. We talked about fluid statics, that is the F equals ma of a fluid field when your acceleration is equal to zero and the fluid's not moving. That led us to things like pressure forces on dams and immersed surfaces. Then we moved into fluid dynamics, what happens when you allow there to be an acceleration on the other side from that F. Especially applied along a streamline, we ended up with the Bernoulli equation. Moved into fluid kinematics, the way fluid elements move, translation, elongation, rotation, shearing, right, and the types of forces that make those occur. We developed this idea of a field representation leading to a material derivative, which got us between the Eulerian and Lagrangian frames of reference, and into the Reynolds transport theorem, which led naturally into the idea of the control volume analysis, which allowed us to apply our classic Lagrangian ideas of conservation of mass, momentum, etc., to an Eulerian frame of reference that is a fixed control volume. If we shrink these control volumes down small enough to the point where they're vanishing, we ended up with differential flow analysis, which with which we used conservation of mass and momentum to derive things like the potential stream functions, the Euler equations, and if we included all the terms we could think to, the Navier-Stokes equations. We used dimensional analysis, right? We set up a relationship that we didn't know how to characterize exactly. We could use something about the physics and the number of dimensions present to come up with a reduced number of pi terms through the pi theorem, which allowed us to develop insights into how things varied with different dimensional groups, Reynolds numbers, Froude numbers, cavitation numbers, Mach numbers, Euler numbers, and how those things described the relative importance of different types of physics in a problem. We used all this preceding knowledge to look at pipe flows, or internal flows, which were a good introduction into fully developed laminar and turbulent flows. And then finally, in this last week, we got into external flows. We characterized different types of boundary layer solutions, the Blasius solution, the von Karman momentum integral, how those describe the way that energy gets pulled out of a boundary layer, resulting in drag, and then to a lesser degree in the last few slides. how pressure forces over a body that is not symmetric with respect to the